Hello and welcome to A Healthy Mind. I'm Dr. Cicelina Grosser-Ledbetter, Director of Counseling and Student Development at the University of the District of Columbia and your host. In 2005, my guest was a single parent in the Army Reserves living in New Orleans. That spring, she learned she would soon be deploying to Iraq. During her mobilization, her life was torn apart by two significant events. In August, she lost everything she owned due to Hurricane Katrina. The very next month, in September, she received a devastating diagnosis of an aggressive head, neck, and throat cancer and was now unable to deploy. Her limited options posed some very hard choices. Because of her illness, she was facing discharge from the military, but she needed complex, full-time medical care, a job, and a place to live with her young son. When searching for what assistance might be available, she was told there were no existing programs for female veterans with children and that she should explore welfare and social services as an option, just like every other single mother. At that moment, Jas Boothe realized that America had forgotten about women who had served, fought, and bled and died alongside their male counterparts. She found her options unacceptable. And for a woman who had honorably served her country, and after extensive cancer treatment, including radiation therapy, that left lifelong side effects. In this program, we're gonna learn more about the challenges faced by women veterans and the organization that Jas Boothe has created to provide the assistance she found lacking at her time of need. Welcome, Captain Jas Boothe.
Hello, thank you for having me.
You're a pretty powerful woman, and I'm really excited to have you here on the show today because you're a hero. And CNN named you as a hero in 2013, and UDC named you as a hero by inviting you to come and speak. And one of the reasons why I wanted to bring you back is because I wanted everybody to be able to hear about you and about Final Salute. Because you're really soft-spoken, but I know there's real power behind what is a very sort of demure presentation. So why do you think that CNN named you a hero?
You know, I guess I'm still kind of struggling with that because I personally don't see myself as a hero. I just see myself as, you know, someone who saw an issue that wasn't being addressed. And just took the initiative to do something about it. I don't see that as being heroic. I just see it as, you know, while serving your country, you know, you're taking an oath to never leave a fallen comrade. And that's one of the more powerful things that stuck with me while serving my country. And that was, you know, why I did what I did and for no other reason.
Yeah. Well, you certainly are a hero. And I just want for all of our viewers to hear your story. I did the intro and I told the story a little bit in snippets, but I want you to talk a little bit about why you ended up starting an organization so powerful like Final Salute and really what the mission is. So start by telling us your story in your own words.
Well, I would say 2005 wasn't one of my more favorite
years.
I don't think I'd had been in New Orleans more than 4 months. I had just relocated there from St. Louis to take a job and join a new unit. And about 4 months into it, I was notified that, hey, by the way, you're going to Iraq. I was a little sad, not because I was going to Iraq, but because I had been geographically separated from my son for so long already, going through military training, that I was looking forward to getting him back full time and reconnecting.
Because he was young.
Yes.
Very young at the time.
Yes. Yeah. So with that, I had to contact my aunt and let her know that I got called up for orders, had to explain everything to my son. And I will say Brandon, he was the perfect child. You hear about so many children that may become rebellious or they've been so detached from their parents, so they start to act out. You know, he was always understanding. He was always a very good son.
And how old, for the context?
Brandon was, I believe, 11 or 12 at that time. I think he was just around turning 12. But even during his younger days, I started the military when he was four. He was always just so very understanding and, okay, I know I'll see you back in a few months or a few weeks or whatever, Mom. So that was truly a blessing. So basically, I got him situated with my aunt back in Missouri. And our mobilization site was Fort Sill, Oklahoma. And I was a postal platoon leader, so we had to go to postal training, which was in Fort McCoy, Wisconsin, which is like the middle of nowhere. So we're training there. We've been there for a month or so, and now it's August. And one of my soldiers came to me and said, ma'am, a hurricane just hit New Orleans. Well, people from that area always, oh, it's no big deal.
Right.
Storms come through
here
all the time.
Yep.
And so he said, no, this one is really bad. And so we all, the ones who are from that area, we all go into the break room to watch on Fox and CNN, and that hurricane is Katrina. And she is a very big deal.
Right, she's a big deal.
And at that particular time, I realized that my son and I had just lost everything that we owned. But at that particular time, there's nothing you can do about it. You know, it was more important, you know, for my troops to make sure the family that they had in the area was okay. I lost things. You know, but my son was safe. So I just say, hey, go contact your family members in the area, make sure they're safe, you know, try to get some contact. And during that whole time I was training, I didn't feel well at all. But at that particular time, you had quite a few service members that were trying to get out of going to the war. And I think my leadership felt that I was one of those. Because I was like, you know, I really don't feel well. And, you know, especially when you're being a woman, you don't want to be sick. You don't want to appear weak. And so they would say, well, you can't go to the doctor today. You know, what about your troops?
And these are men?
Yes.
Just clarify.
You know, what would they say? And so, okay, you know, in the Army, we had this saying called suck it up and drive on. So basically, I would just require you to suck it up and keep working through it. So, however, Hurricane Katrina actually proved to be a blessing for me. So although losing everything, leadership was command directed to give us all 2 weeks to go home and salvage our goods or whatever we could. And I didn't have anything to salvage, so I'm like, you know, I'm gonna go sneak over and go to the doctor now. And so that was actually how I had the opportunity to go to the doctor and check out why I didn't feel well.
In Missouri, or did you go home?
I'm in Oklahoma.
You're in Oklahoma?
I went to the base hospital. And so they called me back 2 weeks later, and the doctor says, hey, I need you to come over and get your test results. And I told him, I have training, sir. Can you just tell me over the phone? And he says, no, I need you to come over. Never in my wildest dreams did I think anything was wrong. So I went over to the doctor's office, and then he tells me to sit down. And I'm like, no, sir, just go ahead and tell me, you know, what's going on so I can go get back to my soldiers. And he says, no, Lieutenant, I need you to sit down. And at that part is when I started to get worried. So I sit down, and he told me that the results of my tests was that I had a malignant mass in my head, neck, and throat area. And so, you know, I'm not a medical professional. So I'm like, what does that mean? And he says, you have cancer. And I responded, no, I don't. So now the denial, the shock and everything is setting in. And so I started to give this colonel all the reasons why I couldn't have cancer. You know, it's not a good time for me. You know, I have a son. I have so much going on.
I'm busy.
Too busy. I don't have time for cancer.
That's right. Gotcha.
And so he said, you're stage two, almost stage three. Meaning you have one of the rare form of cancers that tend to spread quickly and to become very aggressive. And so we need to treat you as soon as possible. And he said, you're not going to be able to deploy anytime soon, and I'm not really sure about your military career beyond that point. And that was kind of not important to me. I was like, I have a son. You know, this little boy is dependent upon me. You know, I'm his everything, I'm his rock, and he's my everything and my rock, and you know, I'm the only parent that he has. You know, nothing can happen to me. And so I had to contact my aunt in Missouri and let her know. And she says, well, what do you want me to tell Brandon? And I said, lie to him. Tell him mom is still training, mm-hmm. mom is still doing all these soldier things, and mm-hmm. even
because you didn't go back after that diagnosis, you stayed.
Right, I had to be immediately sent down to Brooke Army Medical Center in Texas. I was treated between there and Lackland Air Force Base. And even when he would call me, I was there for 6 months. I had 30 surgeries, I'm sorry, two surgeries and 30 radiation treatments.
Wow.
30 cycles of radiation. And even when he would call me, I would say, oh, mom's training, you know, mom's doing this.
Wow.
I would just be able to just muster up enough energy and my voice would start to change. And
sure.
he would, you know, because of the radiation.
Didn't
What's wrong
he?
With your voice?
Yes.
Oh, no, I'm, you know, the training is so
yeah,
hard.
Yeah, 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 yeah. We justify that, right?
Jumping off of mountains. And
yes,
yeah.
yes. That's why I'm hoarse. Right, right.
Right.
And, wow. So how did you take care of you? What did you do? 6 months, no Brandon.
You know, I
radiation.
Tell you, when I first got down there, I was throwing myself, you know, pity parties by the hour. I was angry.
Yes.
And I went out into the lobby. I had locked myself out of my room. Hmm. I went into the lobby to get a new key. And there were about 5 to 6 soldiers being either wheeled in or escorted in. Some of them had been burned unrecognizably. Some of them had limbs that were missing. Some had multiple limbs missing.
Wow.
Some you can tell had severe mental health issues.
Sure.
So they looked just blank on the inside. And so I got my key. I went back to my room and I looked in the mirror.
Ah.
And I said, you know, any one of them, when you looked at me, you couldn't tell anything was wrong with
mm-hmm.
me. And I said, any one of them would trade places with you just
wow.
to be able to recognize mm-hmm. themselves in the mirror.
Mm-hmm.
So young lady, today is your last day of complaining.
Wow.
And so that's what I focused on. There are people, I have brothers and sisters who have been wounded, you know, who have issues that are tougher than mine.
Yeah.
And so
Did you seek mental health treatment during that time?
I didn't. And actually, I've honestly just started to seek mental health issues.
Good for you.
But I tell you, it's hard to be a soldier with problems. It's also even tougher to be a woman soldier with problems.
And you know more about that than anyone. Because
yes.
you have dedicated your life to found this organization. So after the chemo, after the 6 months, you've reconnected with your family, with Brandon, and you came east to DC.
Right.
And then what happened?
Well, let's just go back a little bit.
Okay.
But after finishing the radiation therapy, finishing the surgeries and the treatment, I'm a reservist.
Okay.
And so I have to get off of active duty now. I'm able to stay a reservist. I can be retained in my job, but
yeah.
I have no more employment and I can't go back to New Orleans because it's underwater.
Okay.
So I have no place to go to. I have no, you know, means of employing or taking care of my son. And so I went to my command and it's basically, well, once you leave the reserve, you're off of, you know, Title 10 and they have no further responsibility to me.
And Title 10 is insurance?
That's when you're active duty.
Oh, active duty.
Like
okay.
under U.S. Code.
Okay.
Title 10.
Mm-hmm.
That's what active duty soldiers
okay.
fall under.
Okay.
And so they said, well, you're a veteran now once you come off of duty. So you need to go to Veterans Affairs. And so I contacted Veterans Affairs and said, well, I'm a single mother. I just come off of military duty for medical issues. And I don't have a job or a place to stay. Do you have any programs for women veterans?
Sure.
And it seemed like it was such an odd question to be receiving from them. A woman veteran in need of assistance? We don't have any existing programs, but you did say you were a single mother, right? I said, yes. Well, welfare and social services is available to help single mm-hmm. mothers. I'm like, but I'm a soldier.
Right.
I just served my country. And it's not a nothing to try to put women who haven't served
that.
Down, who on welfare,
right.
but that's not a line I should be in.
That's right.
You know, you have no requirements to serve your country to go and receive welfare and social
that's
services.
Right.
But in return for that, that should be something for us.
Right.
But had I been a man, I mean, you could have run out of options
right.
to choose from.
Right.
There were
right.
tons of transitional
yeah.
housing facilities and
oh,
programs.
Wow. For
and,
men.
Yes, for male veterans.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, like I said, within those 5 or 6 soldiers that were coming in that were wounded amputees, there were women in there.
Wow. So then what happened? What did you do as a result of finding out there were no services for women, for you, for your son?
Well,
then what did you do?
At this time, I'm homeless. You know, so I had to contact my aunt and ask her, you know, can I come stay with you for a while to get back on my feet? And she said, sure. So, you know, I slept on her couch. She had boys, so my son was able to room with her mm-hmm. boys. Mm-hmm. And I was able to get a job with the Missouri Army National Guard. Mm. And this is 2006 now. Mm-hmm. And from 6 months of working there, I went to a school out in Peck, which is in Arkansas. The instructors really liked, you know, my performance and said, we have a program, we're standing up in the DC area. Would you be interested? And I'm like, I get the opportunity to go back and be a full-time soldier.
Yes.
Because that was something I didn't think I would ever be able to do again mm-hmm. because of my issues. And I said, yes, you'd be back full-time as a soldier. And so that's how I ended up mm-hmm. in the Washington, D.C. area in 2006.
And was that one of the programs that you're working on now? Was it home or safe? What program was that?
No, that was just that an was employment just opportunity okay. through the Army
okay.
National Guard.
But something propelled you out of that space to
create?
Well,
you know, I had always thought that my case was isolated. You had never heard of homeless women veterans at that particular time. And so I had, after getting through that situation, I just thought, well, I'm just one person. Why would they do a program for one person?
Yes.
And so I'm up here, and you know, you hear a lot more things being closer to the flagpole, as we call it.
Yes, that's right, that's right.
And I started to hear that, no, there are hundreds of homeless women veterans. No, there's thousands. No, there's tens of thousands. And I was like, okay, well, now we're looking at around 2009, 2010.
Yes.
There has to be some change.
Right.
And so then I went again and started to look for resources for homeless women veterans with children, and I did not find one. And I'm like, how is this happening?
And all you were looking for is a program that would support women veterans on getting back on their feet, like transitional housing, medical
yes.
care, and it was not available.
No.
So then you founded.
Well, I will tell you, hopefully Oprah never sees this.
Okay, it's okay.
Oprah did a show late that okay. year on homeless women veterans.
Yes.
And I'm looking and she's showing the woman living in her car because you had heard about it, but you had never seen
yes.
it before.
Yes.
And I immediately got angry, but I'm angry at Oprah because mm-hmm. in my mind, Oprah can solve all of the world's problems because
yeah.
she has
sure.
money.
Sure.
And I'm like, you know, Oprah, why are you building these schools over in Africa? Why are you doing so much for them? Why aren't you helping these women?
Mm-hmm.
You should be helping these women. You can
yeah.
do something. And that's when I received my calling.
Wow.
At that particular moment. And I realized that is what God
wow.
needed me to do.
Wow.
And now it came full circle on why I lost everything I own, why I got that medical diagnosis. They say, you know, God, he has a radical
yeah,
process.
Yeah, all over the place. Yes, very radical process.
But it hit me at that point that, you know, it doesn't take, or you can say you don't need a cape to be someone's hero.
That's right.
Or it doesn't take a person to have $1 million to make the difference or impact one person's
right,
life.
Right.
So I just started there by finding my organization and just starting on one person at a
yeah.
time.
And your organization is called Final Salute.
Yes.
And you call yourself an activator.
Yes.
And an advocate.
Yes.
For homeless women veterans.
Yes.
What does that mean?
Well, you know,
an
you
activator.
Well, there has to be, when you're looking at change, you know, we have politicians who are basically paid and voted on to talk about stuff.
Right.
And to bring awareness to these issues. But if nothing's changing, that means there's no action mm-hmm. being done beyond those mm-hmm. talks. And so I definitely wanted to raise awareness and advocate for homeless women veterans, but I also wanted to be a catalyst for change by actually providing those services that are missing, services that I would have love to have for me and my child, you know, in return for the service and sacrifice that I've rendered to my country.
And what are some of the core services that you provide with Final Salute?
We provide safe and suitable housing for homeless women veterans and their children. And we also prevent homelessness through emergency financial assistance, oh. which is something that women veterans really can't get either.
Mm-hmm.
But people always ask, well, you know, what's the solution? You need to buy more houses? I'm like, no, we need to have less homeless veterans.
Right,
you know?
right.
That's the solution to the problem. But we as a country have become so reactive
okay.
to everything in dealing with veterans mm-hmm. that now, you know, the issues become, you know, tripled and quadrupled.
Mm-hmm.
But they do have systems that are working on veterans issues as a whole.
Mm-hmm.
But when it came to women veterans, they were, you know, 100% an afterthought.
That is amazing that they were an afterthought. So now you have a couple of like key programs. One is called SAFE.
Yes.
And the other is called HOME.
Right.
Okay. So tell me.
Okay. HOME is our housing, transitional housing program.
Okay.
That's housing, outreach, mentorship, and encouragement.
Okay.
The things that we feel are all vital components of getting them back on their road to independence.
Got it. So that's transitional. So it can be anywhere from really short time to
Yes, up the 2 years is max.
Okay, 2 years.
And, you know, some women just need 3 months. Some just need 6 months.
And their children.
Yes.
Right.
And their children. You know, the GAO Government Accountability Office put a report out in 2011 that of over 60% of the government-funded transitional housing programs did not take in women or women with children. And so they were still even catering to men or single women at that time. But they were asked why. Well, the VA or the federal funding doesn't pay for the children. And so there was no financial incentive for them to take in the children, because if we give up beds to children, then that's money out of our pocket. So I'm like, are you serving the mission or are you serving your pocket?
Wow.
You know, we've already, even though I didn't go to Iraq, I was deployed later on to Kosovo.
Mm-hmm.
And I left my child. And there are plenty of other women who have deployed who have left their children. And so it's a slap in the face to have to be separated, go to a combat zone, or go to these other areas where you're serving, and then come back on American soil and be separated again because you were forgotten about.
Wow. And that's why you call women the forgotten heroes.
Yes.
The women veterans, the forgotten heroes of America.
Yes.
Wow. So now that you've gotten the programs established, what is it that you need? Is the government doing enough? Are families doing enough? I know I see that reaction. And
well, I probably answer that question differently from how people would think I would answer that question.
Okay.
Because whenever you ask people about, is the government doing enough? Or, you know, why is the government doing X,
sure.
Y, and Z? The uniform that I wear said U.S. Army, you know. And so it didn't say the VA's Army.
Mm.
You know, we as American can always rise to everyone else's crisis. You know, when Haiti happened, you know, we couldn't text or donate fast enough and send checks. And, you know, celebrities getting on their private jets and going over there. And let's help these, you know, poor women that are displaced with their children. You know, same thing in Indonesia.
Yep.
You know, we made a beeline over there with our money, with our supplies. And again, you know, look at these poor women and children. And when you say, hey, did you know that there are tens of thousands of homeless women veterans on America's soil? And America's general response is, oh, what is the VA doing? The VA needs to do something about that.
Mm-hmm.
We don't have that same sense of urgency for our own women and children.
Why?
Especially because America does not equate the service and sacrifice as equal to the service and sacrifice of the men. I think in their minds, when we're deployed to Iraq and Afghanistan, we must be all working in the kitchen or, you know, must be working in supply. But, you know, there are no front lines. Even with the combat exclusion that allow us to serve, there have long been any front lines. You know, once you step on, you know, foreign soil, you know, that is your front line.
Right. And that reminds me, there's a bill out, or there's a lot of conversation around the Hill about women serving on the front line, whatever that means. And you'll help me if I'm misspeaking. What are your thoughts about women serving in combat alongside men?
Well, I personally think, you know, once you've been able to carry a child for 9 months and put it out your body, you've already been through combat.
You've already been through combat, okay.
But, you know, you've had women that have, again, they've already been fighting. They've already had to pick up a weapon and return fire.
Yes.
You know, they've already had to take cover for their lives. You know, when insurgents look at a uniform, they don't say, oh, see if she has a pony, see if that person has a ponytail, or, you know, look at the curvature of her body and see if that's a woman. All they see is a person that they want to harm.
Yes.
You know, so we're fair game, just like our brothers are. You know, when you're rolling over a IED, you know, it doesn't maneuver around the woman's body because, you know, she's a female.
That's right.
It wants to kill, maim, and harm anybody that's in its way.
Right.
You know, so to say, well, just because I'm not an infantryman doesn't mean that I'm not, you know, in the same harm as my brother, or doesn't mean that I'm gonna, you know, be facing the same dangers as my brother. You know, combat exclusion is a technicality.
It
sounds sexy.
Yes.
But it's something that's already been going on. You've had women that have died. You know, you've had, you know, mothers, children that didn't get to see their mothers. I'm sorry.
It's okay.
You've had children that, you know, the last time they saw their mothers was at the flight line into. Next time see your mother in a box, you know, don't tell me women are not in combat or that our service and sacrifice isn't the same. Tell that to the children and see what response that you would get. And that's why I fight so hard for them, because these are my sisters, and they've given just as much as our brothers have.
Yeah. And so what gives you resilience? How do you keep going? Who's your hero?
I would say my husband and my children have been my backbone. My husband is also a veteran. He served in the Marine Corps. And my oldest son, Brandon, who was with me during Katrina, he now serves in the Air Force. So we are a military family, true and true. Then I have my little three-year-old,
yes.
who's my little cheerleader,
yes.
who's great. And also right now, I also have a two-year-old little girl in my house. Her mother was previously in one of our transitional homes. She was a reservist. A lot of people don't realize that guardsmen and reservists are also facing hard financial times too. And she got deployed to Afghanistan. And so she couldn't have,
wow.
she had no help with her daughter. And she said, hey, will you help me with her?
Yeah.
So now we have our little addition to our family too. We have a little girl.
We have about 15 seconds. What would
okay.
you like to leave for America, for people who are watching? What do you want them to know about female or women veterans?
That their sacrifice is the same. And they need just as much of your support as the men do. And again, veterans are not a government responsibility. They're an American responsibility.
That's a great final word. Thank you, Captain Jas Boothe.
Thank
you for being my guest. If you would like to get more information about Jas Boothe and Final Salute, Inc., you will find it on the web at www.finalsaluteinc.org. You may also call 866-720-9171 or 703-224-8845. If you'd like to reach me, you can visit me on Facebook and Twitter at Dr. Sis, or you can find more information on my website at www.drsislina.com. I'm Dr. Cislina Grosser-Ledbetter. Thank you for watching, and I'll see you next time on A Healthy Mind.
You almost got me.